And again, this is another picture, guys. It's another picture of our transducer, okay? Try to give you guys multiple sources. So our power supply, of course, would be our cord, our wire, right? Our wire. That's where we get our electrical signals coming from, you know, our source through the transducer, causing vibration of this. Mind you, you can see right here, this is active elements, right? These are all active elements, however many are lined up across here. On our 12 transducer, maybe it's 250 on that 4 centimeter length transducer, that the 12 that you guys are using for thyroids, is 250 transducers lined up across there. Very small elements, okay? All of them have their own connection to electricity, okay? Called a circuit, all right? So that electrical current is gonna cause vibration of the PGT. It's gonna send out multiple sound waves. Sound waves gonna hit a structure, bounce back, gonna cause pressure or vibration against this PGT. This PGT is gonna create electrical signal going back to the power supply, back to the ultrasound system. Transmission, reception. Okay. All right, acoustic insulator right there. Our acoustic insulator right there. And we have our matching layer. Like I said, it actually touches the patient. Look how thick our backing material is. Because we want the sound to stop as soon as possible, okay? If we let it keep ringing, again, that's gonna degrade our image. Gonna degrade our image, okay? So let's talk about the PGT or active element, guys, all right? So the piezoelectric effect describes the property of certain materials to create a voltage when they are mechanically deformed when pressure is applied to them, okay? So again, remember I said that happens during reception. Again, it describes certain materials to create a voltage when pressure is applied to them, okay? So the sound waves applying pressure during reception is gonna cause that PGT to vibrate. That PGT is special material that creates an electrical voltage when the pressure is applied to it, okay? That's called the piezoelectric effect. The reverse piezoelectric effect occurs when a voltage is applied to the PGT, and that's gonna create our sound waves, okay? That happens during, I don't know why it's not on there. Is it in the one I sent you? I don't have transmission and reception on it?
Yes.
Yeah, I don't know why. I don't know what's going on with this one. Yeah, so the reverse piezoelectric effect occurs during transmission. We're good there with the piezoelectric effect, guys?
No, this is not the one you sent us.
No, this is, I'm tripping on that too. I don't know how I just pulled that up and it's not. It vibrates to generate a sound wave when applied with the voltage. All right? So our wire coming in right here, causing sound waves, causing that PGT to vibrate, is gonna create sound waves, and the same during reception. Reception is the piezoelectric effect. Transmission is the reverse piezoelectric effect. Okay. The piezoelectric element generates a voltage when applied in vibration, an ultrasonic wave is produced. Look at that. Just for visual purpose, for my visual learning. Okay. So let's talk about piezoelectric materials. Materials that convert sound into electricity and vice versa are called piezoelectric or ferroelectric. Okay. So if a material can convert sound into electricity or electricity to sound, that is gonna be called piezoelectric material or ferroelectric material, all right? Some piezoelectric materials occur naturally, such as quartz and tourmaline. Those are naturally piezoelectric materials right there. But the ones we use in clinical transducers are man-made, okay? Are synthetic, such as lured zirconate, titanate, or PGT. I want you guys to know our man-made lead, zirconate, titanate, or PGT from our naturally occurring PGT elements, quartz and tourmaline. Okay. The man-made would be lead, zirconate, titanate, or PGT. our natural ones are quartz and tourmaline. Quartz and tourmaline are natural elements. Okay. Some synonyms of PGT, we already talked about these guys. Ceramic, active element, or the crystals. Or the crystal. So from here on out, however I say that term, you know, I don't know, because I use all these terms synonymously. You know, so however I say it, I need you guys to know what I'm talking about. Whether I say PGT, PGT element, active element, you know, ceramic,
or crystal.
There's a little chart of natural, things going on, natural and the man-made one. Natural, quartz, tourmaline, man-made, lead, zirconate, titanium. Or synthetic. So, guys, I'm gonna take a test. Don't ask me what synthetic is. It's fake. It's man-made. It's like when you get conventional oil versus synthetic oil, right?
Mm-hmm.
Synthetic oil is built to be more efficient, right? That's why you can go half a year without getting one oil change. You know, when you have conventional oil, you have to get oil change every 3,000 miles. So that's why we use the man-made ones, because they're built better for ultrasound transducers to transmit sound and, you know, from electricity and things of that nature. Okay? They're built for those specific purposes. All right? The piezoelectric material do not occur spontaneously. The piezoelectric effect does not occur spontaneously. Okay? We kind of talked about this last semester. We were talking about the Curie brothers, right? Talking about the Curie brothers at Curie temperature and things like that. So polarization, guys, again, you know I love my, I hooked you up, guys. These are all, if you see it in highlighted, when we have our terminology quiz, you know, you'll know what to study now, right? Because all your definitions, all your terms are highlighted, okay?
Easy to see?
Polarization. You okay? Okay. Ooh, get you little mad. Oh, you got a bacteria.
I ain't
got my flu shot yet. Come on, Polarization, guys, is the process that creates piezoelectric properties by exposing the material to a strong electrical field while being heated to a substantial temperature. So that's what's happening as well, is that this material is also being heated. And the man-made ones are better built to take that heat exchange. Right. The Curie temperature, Curie point, is the temperature at which the PGT is polarized. Simple as that. That is the temperature that needs to be, the minimum temperature that needs to be reached for the PGT to be polarized. That's what the Curie temperature, Curie point is. When we talked about these guys, it was two brothers, right? Mm-hmm. Named after the scientists who discovered the piezoelectric effect.
Two brothers.
Piezoelectric properties can also be destroyed by exposure to high temperatures if the PGT is heated above the Curie point, which is why we're not allowed to put transducers in the autoclave. That's why we clean them the way we do, because they would cause the PGT to be non-functioning, because they're heated above the Curie point when they're in an autoclave. Autoclave being what they use to clean surgical utensils and the OR. Okay. Depolarization is the loss of piezoelectric properties. The PGT is said to be polarized. Depolarized. So polarization, the process that creates piezoelectric properties, depolarization, the loss of piezoelectric properties, the loss of that ability to take electricity and turn it into sound, or take sound and turn it into electricity. Okay, that's what we're talking about. We're talking about polarization versus depolarization. The Curie point, or Curie temperature, that's just the temperature that PGT is polarized to create the piezoelectric effect. If it's heated above the Curie point, then it's going to lose those piezoelectric properties. All right. What else? Oh, I'm asking. All right. So this gets us into how we clean our transducers. Again, I've already said that that's the reason why we would love to be able to sterilize our probe every single time, right? 100% safety, you know? But then our transducer would lose their piezoelectric properties, therefore being depolarized, all right? So sterilization, guys, that's the destruction of all microorganisms by exposure to extreme heat, chemical agents, or radiation, such as an autoclave. Sterilization is the destruction of all microorganisms. We don't sterilize anything concerning our transducers, right? Mm-hmm. We just disinfect them. Okay? That's important to know that when it comes to ultrasound transducers, we just disinfect our transducers. Okay? That's the application of a chemical agent to reduce or eliminate infectious organisms on an object, such as when you're using your cavity wipes, right? Or when you're at Bentov and you have to pour that big jug of, Cydex on top of the transducer. Which that went away, guys. Everybody's going to have, we finally come into the 21st century in here. So I've been using Trophon for like 8 years now, something like that. And we're just not getting our Trophon machines. You know, so that's great right there. So everybody here has to go to Trophon training because that's how, in the new world, all the time, chances of being clean. For us, we're only doing the VADs and the transducer, but you can do regular transducers with this. Okay. So, disinfection attempts to significantly reduce the microbial load and the spread of bacteria. Okay. So, sterilization, destroying all microorganisms, okay? Disinfection, reducing the infectious disease process, not destroying organisms.
But it's still gonna have some infection. Because the way we clean it, it's not 100%.
Absolutely not. Yeah. Absolutely not. Which is why you just don't go in the room and just start grabbing transducers, right?
Yeah.
Don't do that in the morning. I told you what can happen. You grab a transducer and you look on the last exam and it was a scrub. And you're like, man, I didn't touch this transducer, bare hands. Okay. So, medical instruments have the highest potential to transmit infection by penetrating the skin or mucous membranes, therefore requiring sterilization. We don't break the skin, right? We go inside body cavities, but we never penetrate the skin to use our transducers. Okay? That's why they have like sterile gel, sterile probe covers. If we do need to be in a sterile environment, we do have those things. You know, so you'll see on portable, some people will break out that little tube of sterile gel.
Mm-hmm.
You know, especially if you're doing something on an open wound, right? Has anybody done exams on open wounds before? Like lower extremities, where they have like a diabetic ulcer, arterial ulcers.
I saw that's an outbreak.
Yeah, and so they're going to get the transducer all dressed up, right?
Yeah.
Cover it up, you know, because as long as, just like when you're doing a transvaginal, right? You put the gel in there so we're able to transfer the sound, right?
Yeah.
But you can do the same thing. You can, there's been plenty of times I done used a nitrile glove and put some gel in it, wrapped it around and put a rubber band around it so the transducer face didn't have to touch a patient's open wound or sore or what have you, or abscess, like when I did a breast abscess before, you know, so it just doesn't have to touch that because then we're going to, being like that, we're going to need to be sterilized that probe.
Yeah, but hold on. MVJ,
mm-hmm.
They use the sterilized gel
mm-hmm.
for endometrial,
yeah.
But in the Smith,
they do
regular gel.
Yeah.
That's fine. Again, you need sterile things when you're breaking the skin.
The vagina is
already an open organ, you know, it's open access. So it's not, you're not breaking the skin to do it. Okay.
So it's not.
It doesn't require sterilization for that exam. It doesn't require. I'm trying to think of the right term. It's already an open orifice. Mm-hmm. Okay.
So would you need to sterilize
like your mouth.
Like the regular transducer if it was in the glove on an open wound when you're doing it on an open wound or no?
No, because we don't, remember, we just disinfect. We don't sterilize transducers.
Well, I mean, do you have to disinfect it?
Definitely. I'm going to do
with
all
what?
Of that. Huh?
With what?
Whatever your area is using. Like right now, aren't you guys using cavity wipes and plastic on? That's how I clean it. We were using the T-spray at first, right? You know, some people use You know, it depends on where you are, they're gonna use different, that's why I can't just nail down one thing. Because,
so it's not like something, an extra step, like?
No, it's not an extra step.
Okay.
We're just gonna clean it to the best of our abilities and protect the transducer, protect ourselves. Okay? Ultrasound transducers are less likely to transmit infections because they rarely penetrate mucous membranes and only require disinfection, okay? We don't have to break the skin to do these ultrasounds. A lot of times, even when the skin is already broken, it's already exposed to whatever kind of infection is already out in the open, okay? So even if it's already broken, remember I told you guys, I've done the leg before. I don't know if you guys are the seniors. I've done the leg that was so, that had so much fluid on it, that it was so saturated with fluid that the skin just, the leg just broke open, the whole leg just bust open during the exam, okay? And the skin was just, it just couldn't stretch anymore. It just lost all its elasticity. It just bust right open. That skin is already exposed to whatever microbial organisms are in the air, you know? So in that case, you know, luckily I didn't have to like do anything. You know, I just finished my exam like normal, you know, but that's not considered us, you know, requiring sterilization because that skin is already exposed. Me going in there with a, that's why, you know, if you ever do a biopsy, even though the ultrasound doesn't penetrate, we have to guide those needles, right? So of course those needles have to be sterilized, but also the probe cover that's in front, that's holding the transducer, has to be sterilized because it's touching the skin where that break is. Transducers should be disinfected with Cydex or some other cold germicide. Everybody here knows what Cydex is, right? That's what you drop the transducers in, they'll be touched. Not to be exposed to extreme temps to prevent depolarization and loss of properties, right? Again, that's why we don't put things in the autoclave, okay? Thermal damage to the adhesives and bonding agents may occur, okay? The matching layer, have y'all ever seen that peeling up on the transducer? So that's what happens when it has heat damage. Though the adhesive that's keeping the matching layer intact, it'll peel up. Therefore, we can lose those properties a lot faster, you know, when the transducer's messed up. That leads me to some images right here, guys, of how it looks when it is damaged. So let's take this one right here. You can see it looks like this whole matching element is completely off of this transducer. So we're losing our protection to the PZT, okay? So our crystals are, you know, maybe being exposed or a lot closer to the skin, to the surface than what they need to be. All right, so you see right here, it's kind of chipping away. Guys, if you see stuff like this, that's degrading our images. Please let somebody know. We have a transducer in the lab I just found out about that's like this. I just happened to be in lab the other day. It's a C5. You know, I haven't been in lab, so I haven't seen a transducer in a while. But I seen that the wire is being exposed. You know, that could cause somebody's shock. So I got to take this transducer out of service today so I can make a...